Lux presents Hollywood. Lever Brothers Company, the makers of Lux toilet soap, bring you the Lux Radio Theater, starring Margaret O'Brien, Lionel Barrymore, Lewis Stone, and Edward Arnold in Three Wise Fools. Ladies and gentlemen, your producer, Mr. William Keeley.
Greetings from Hollywood, ladies and gentlemen. If when you're sitting at home some quiet night, alone, you suddenly hear a sound like this. Have you ever wondered what makes that gate unwind? Could it possibly be those little people, the leprechauns and the fairies whom we never see? You don't believe in them, eh? Well then, let's see what happens to three skeptics like yourselves in Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer's Three Wise Fools, based on the play by Austin Strong, originally produced by John Golden. We are fortunate in having all four stars from the original fine cast: Margaret O'Brien, Lionel Barrymore, Lewis Stone, and Edward Arnold. Margaret appears as a little Irish girl who moves into the home and heart of three hard-hearted disbelievers. Disbelieving, that is, in those same little people who are known to inhabit the bogs of Ireland. And speaking of Ireland, we have a letter forwarded by a youthful member of the Red Cross. It's from a pupil in a school near Dublin, and says in part, "Words cannot express how grateful we were for the welcome presents that you sent. The teacher let us pick what we liked, and I chose a cake of Lux soap and a storybook." Well, I'm sure that boys and girls in Ireland, as in other lands, appreciate the packages the Junior Red Cross sends, and especially their kindness and discrimination in including Lux soap. Here's Act One of Three Wise Fools, starring Margaret O'Brien as Sheila O'Monaghan, Lionel Barrymore as Richard Gaunt, Lewis Stone as James Trumbull, and Edward Arnold as Theodore Finley. Many years ago, three young suitors, a doctor, a banker, a lawyer, each was desperately enamored of the beautiful Lena Fairchild. But suddenly, Miss Fairchild fell in love with a stranger, a dark man from Ireland, so full of song and poetry that she agreed to run away with him. The three suitors discovered the eloper, and so violently did they threaten the stranger that he turned in his saddle to curse them.
"I am the O'Monaghan, who's broken bread with kings and sung before queens, and this is my curse. No, not a curse. I'll make it a blessing. Gentlemen, while Rena and I are in Ireland, may all your lofty dreams come true. May you..."
"Richard Gaunt."
"May you be the famous man of medicine. And you..."
"James Trumbull."
"And you be the high and mighty lawyer you set your heart upon. And you..."
"Theodore Finley."
"May you get your $1,000,000, your glittering ton of gold, and may you go side by side on a wide, smooth road. In the name of the one-horned witch of the Bog of Ardee, it is spoken."
Well, 40 years went by, and the three disappointed suitors had become three old bachelors. Theodore Finley had acquired his ton of gold. Richard Gaunt became a famous doctor, and James Trumbull, a high and mighty lawyer. But with it all, they hadn't acquired one true friend. And so it was that the three old bachelors contemplated doing of a gracious deed.
"I still say it's ridiculous, giving away a piece of property worth $50,000 just because you two are worried about how many carriages will be at your funeral.
And how many do you think you have at yours?"
"So we're making this magnificent gesture because the people of this community hate me. Is that it, Dr. Gaunt?"
"Why, they love you, Ted. That's why they call you Squeeze of Pennington."
"Oh, now, stop arguing. If we can buy a little goodwill with a gift, it's a bargain."
"And to whom will we give the property?"
"The university, of course. For years they've wanted that land to build a Greek amphitheater.
We get some wonderful publicity in the newspaper."
"Yes, Paul Badger owns the newspaper and Paul Badger hates us."
"Well, now, speak for yourself. You were the one who dispossessed his mother 25 years ago."
"I'm a businessman."
"Well, then, as a businessman, shut up." Jim, get in touch with the president of the university. I'll get a hold of Badger, and they can both come here tomorrow.
Well, is there anything I can do?
Yes. You go to the vault in that bank of yours and bring us the deed for the land. The deed of the old Fairchild estate.
Well, have you seen today's newspaper?
Leading citizens give university old Fairchild estate.
Well, now we can be proud of ourselves. This star won't forget us in a hurry. What is it, Frederick?
Excuse me, gentlemen, but a little girl and a man are calling. They look like immigrants.
Immigrants?
Well, send them away.
Now, who could they be?
Little Cookie Moon, you know, sir, can tell me so, Dragon.
Who are you, little girl?
Kilo O'Malahan. And there's not a cottage nor a castle in all Ireland that's not honored by his presence.
O'Malahan, did you say?
Yes, sir. Granddaughter of Michael D. O'Malahan.
Well, it's Rena Fairchild's granddaughter.
Look at this man, will you?
Oh, Carpenter's the name, sir. The O'Malahan servant, man and boy, for 50 years.
Well, where's your grandfather, Charles? Is he with you?
Grandis in Connemara. He got it from on the hill. Then he's straight up in his grave.
Standing up?
And why not? He lies against no man. God rest his soul. Granny's gone too.
Rena Fairchild is dead.
And because of her great kindness to you three gentlemen, she commissioned me to deliver to you her most precious treasure.
Well, really? What is it?
To order Sydney Sheriff.
It's what? Her granny wanted you to be her guardian.
Well, why can't her parents take care of her?
She had none. Then passed none when she was a baby.
No, but we don't know anything about raising a little girl.
Oh, she's a smart one, gentlemen. What you don't know, she'll teach you. Right as a new gentleman.
Oh, you bloody man. If you do need a woman about, someone that could be needed for your cost when your buttons go upstairs.
Thank you, but we have a tailor.
Ah, but there's no love in the thread and you'd love a tailor.
My dear child, please. It's quite impossible.
I'm sorry. I should have known. You don't fancy.
Oh, it isn't that at all. It's simply that, well...
Don't go, gentlemen. Don't you all stand. That's good,
you are. Is there something you can do, old devil? A few dollars or so?
Aye, there is something you can do. For the blasphemous thought I'm thinking, you can pray for me, Lord. Tell me, lady.
Frederick?
Yes, Mr. Kendall?
A competent butler would have spared us all that.
Yes, sir. I'm begging your pardon, the university president, Mr. Appleby.
Miss Appleby? Come in, sir.
Oh, this gentleman,
sir,
has been a terrible mistake. Mistake?
I
knew he should have held off with that publicity.
Now, what's the matter with the publicity? You think it's fine?
But, gentlemen, the deed to the Fairchild estate. The deed you turned over to me is not the deed to the Fairchild estate. Here, look at it.
Well, what are you talking about? We bought that property from Rena Fairchild years ago.
This deed is for a Rena Fairchild property on the other side of town. 10 acres of swampland.
What is the newspaper here to this?
No. I'll have it straightened out immediately.
Yes. Oh, I hope so, Mr. Finger. He said I just sent in another front-page story, and it would be most embarrassing if you did this.
Mr. Appleby, I'll see that you get the right deed in the morning.
Yes, of course. Well, I... Good afternoon, gentlemen.
You have it. You told us for years you had that deed.
Yes, I know, but giving the university 10 acres of swamp. Do you realize what Badger can do to us? He'll be hooted out of town.
That Badger won't find out about it.
You'll buy it right now.
You'll buy it?
From who?
From Rena, of course. I'll cable her. Ah, Rena's dead, you lame brain.
Well, then the heir.
Say, she's the heir. That little girl.
And you sent her away.
All right.
I did nothing of the sort.
We'll argue about it later now. But right now, we've got to find her. Does it? Get the carriage.
Look at poor Bobby. Granny's house. It's falling to pieces.
Right now. There's nothing left but to take out your American citizenship and go on the old age pension.
Would this charity of proportion or stand that you live?
So we can't live in this dilapidated with old Savannah.
I know. Poor Gavin, I'm afraid. What are you doing?
Here, girl. I'll do it. I'll go to work.
Oh, no.
I will. I'll get it out.
What did it be like I was telling you? Slavery. Oh, I feel like Simon McGee.
Then there's not left but to tell this old place.
Tell it. Tell it, Granny. Don't you ever... Oh, Gavin, look. The oak tree.
Hmm? What about that oak tree?
What is the body? There is with an oak tree. The good people, the lesser kind. Glory be, they'll help us out of our trouble.
What are you going to do?
Stand where you are, old Gavin. I'm going to call them forth.
Yes, sir, yes. I don't see nothing, my lady. Not a solitary fairy.
You mean that it's forgotten their dance, living so long and receiving all
the wounds? Yes, of course.
Dirty, steady, big and small, touching sea and water's path. Come out from your fairy bays and get some troubles all away. Oh, please, little fairy, please come out. I need your help so bad. I know you're only walking because Brenda said you were. Oh, please come out.
Not a sign of him.
So what more can I do you up to, little fairy? I'm going to come out wide than that. I'm only a mortal, but I've got some business, please. And it's Gavin, look.
Here,
my lady, here. No, not the fairy, the gentleman. That's the band who's the trouble in Mr. Kimball. Oh, you think that lady is the one? I didn't expect it to stay
there. Is it there?
Hey, what have you come here for?
The dog is here.
Don't you apologize, Peter. But there's your home and live with us.
Oh, Lordy, Lordy.
Hey, then you will come.
Oh, yes, yes. Think about your daddy.
Well, wouldn't you we have to come too?
Well, I couldn't go without your daddy.
Well, then.
I promised Tommy I'd take care of him. But Gavin's a very commanding seat.
You might have waited till they caught you at it, my lady.
Bring your bag to the carriage.
Where is this in New York, sir? If there is any of you in them branches, I hope you know what you're doing.
Speak up, Jim. Speak up. Did you see Judge Washington, gentlemen? Our worries are over. We have become the leaders of the Sheila O'Manahan.
Good. What did she have to say about
her? Said to the judge. You should have heard her telling Watson how much she loves us.
And what about the deed to leave his estate?
None of them, sir.
Judge arranged that, too.
The child gets the $50,000, which we will hold in trust for her, and the property's ours, turn over to the university.
There.
Here's the deed.
Well, I think this all truly is true.
To our dear, beloved little ward,
what's your name again?
Sheila.
Sheila.
Oh, yes, yes, Sheila. Long live Sheila.
But not Sheila. I've wired Miss Marlowe soon, Philadelphia. They'll be glad to enroll the child any time we wish.
That's excellent. The best place for us.
For me, too. I'm sick of going around with a silly grin in my face just because the kid wants me to look happy all the time.
Come in, come in.
I have the honor to announce for the most powerful inspection, Miss Sheila O'Mara.
Yes. Yeah. Well, you look very nice, my dear. That a new dress?
Thank you, Grandma. A dabbing dress. And you could see others. Foxes and foxes.
Four parts to you.
No, fine, Lord Devlin, fine. I hope you took them all on approval.
Oh, but I do approve, I do. A dabbing for communication.
I really?
Where's your senior? A doll's house. Is that really true?
No, that's not a doll's house, my dear. That's the model of a big theater. The biggest in the country.
Entirely based with marble.
And if it hadn't been for you, Sheila, they could never do it.
Yes, it's going to be built on your granny's place,
and you're going to make a lot of money out of it.
Oh, granny's place?
And this is the paper that gave us the right to sell it.
Yes, it's a wonderful sale, of course, inside of you. But then my son could be one of the men. His grandest lot of money.
Yes, Sheila, he wished that he's a broad, smooth road, and
we have had pretty fair going.
Yes, that one horn hit certainly did all right by us.
One horn, did it?
Uh-huh.
Not the one horn that was a vagabond,
yes, that's the one. Vagabond.
Oh, no, no. And it wasn't a blessing. It was a curse of the most terrible old witch in all Ireland.
Well, he wished me $1 million, Peter, and I've got it.
He's a poor, poor darling. I must use the post office.
Yes, Don't worry about it. Tomorrow, maybe, huh?
Well, no, no, now. Very minute.
No, now, Peter, let's be sensible about this.
I am. So you see, just puffing on the edge of my...
Oh, my heavens, that is good.
Just now, cross your fingers for a vicious thing. Cross me one horn, but I call you forth and command you to take the post office and send it out. I, Peter, stand over of Michael, V. O'Manahan, who till now broker is a spell and a doctor, the banker and the judge. Lie back in his to the bag of ideas. He's gone. His eyes, Peter, have spoken. There. That over there, gentlemen. Now, if you excuse me, I'll get up to meet you
suddenly. Well, Peter, you're taking that paper.
But this is the paper that Boston told me about, isn't it?
Yes, but you can have it to build a big theater.
I'm sorry, but then I'll be going to see us for the big something.
What?
Really, grandmother, to be like the new man in the house.
Well, this is a fine set of a bridge.
What's the whole heck about, my lady? A theater and a piece of paper.
I think it's going to give me a lot of money for grandmother, sir.
And why?
To be the theater for the Greeks.
A theater for the Greeks?
Yes. All the theaters could last.
Oh, excuse me, lady, there's an order of last to me about this house.
I don't know anything. Or do I? Or have a notion?
Maybe one would have got to watch the water. Now, that's theater. You keep it in a big place, my lady.
I keep it in a book. Come on.
Here,
Glenn. Here. You're so sweet. I just wanted to kiss you
goodnight, Dr. Winthrop. You said goodnight downstairs.
I'm not kidding you. Suppose you're the nicest you say when you really care about it.
All right, all right. Get me and make it quick.
I don't kiss you while you're looking like an old man.
Well, I don't feel like smiling. I've been smiling all day. What's that piece of paper from the night guy? If you were to give me that piece of paper, I think maybe I could smile.
I make you smile without the paper.
Young lady, I haven't laughed in years.
Do you know what a laugh is, Dr. Mitchell? A laugh is a little ball of air with a good laugh. You start to your tummy and go up to your office after this, trying to get into your mouth.
Don't get one inside of you now. Yes, Dr. Mitchell. You undersized female.
Ah, but the poor thing's lost its way. It's crawling up your spine. It's coming out of your ear. I can see it. It's up into your skin. It's crawling down your jawbone. Besides, Dr., don't open your mouth if you jump right here.
Oh, yeah.
I told you. Don't you kiss now. Good night, Dr. Mitchell. You got it on your skin now.
What are you laughing at, good sucker? You're in trouble. You're right up to your head.
I'm sorry if I disturbed you, darling.
Very nice. I was only waiting. What is it you want?
To touch you in.
Touch me in?
I have to take care of you now that you're inviting me.
My dear young lady, you're not taking care of us, we're taking care of you. That's why we must, that's why we'd like to have that paper back.
I'll hear no more about this paper. Now, sit down.
We'll go down, please.
Yes, so I can kiss you and kiss you goodnight.
You want to kiss me goodnight? Why?
Because I love you.
Oh,
but no one ever touched me when you took me
before. No, not for a very long time. And I'm an old man now.
Well, my boy,
That's what Sheila said, isn't it? That's why she can't have the tree moved, isn't it?
Well.
Well, I've got the solution. Just now, while I was at the bank, a parade went by. Dugan's Lilliputians are in town. They'll be at the Vaudeville House all week. Such the perfect midgets for the band. And I've hired them.
You what?
Yeah. I've told Dugan exactly what to say. So tonight, right after dinner, you and I and Sheila are taking a walk to the Fairchild Estate.
Look, Sheila, a three-quarters moon. Do you know what that means?
Yes, it's the favorite moon of the little folk. And it's just getting nice for them to be gallivanting.
Well, that's why we thought it would be nice to walk over here, Sheila, to the oak tree. There's no telling what we might see.
Wait a minute. Where's old Gavin? Wasn't he coming with us?
I'm afraid old Gavin is a bit indisposed. He said he got lost in your cellar.
Oh, Sheila, that man. That man's nothing but a drunken old...
That's enough.
I told him where he'd be. He said he'd follow us to Fable.
Well, there's no need to wait. Now, let's start looking for the fairies, huh?
So close your eyes, everyone. Pookie, pookie, the apple small. Ace the bloom and on the knee. Down, rise, storm of yours. The last must ruin the cellar. You can open your eyes now. You can. Look, the tree. In your tree.
Music. I hear music.
The good people, they're there. Oh, don't you see them?
Yes, I see them.
Listen,
someone's talking.
Fellow Leprechaun, our fairy queen has asked me to explain why she has ordered us to move out of this tree. We are leaving because the heart of the roots is dying. Yes, our tree has angina pectoris and is no longer a fitting home for us little people. In fact, the poor little tree can be cut down and put out of its misery.
Sheila, did you hear that?
The fairy queen has found us a new home far away. So let us depart while the moon's on the rise and the dew's on the grass. Come, little people. Away!
There they go, Sheila. There they go. They're packed on their backs.
I see him. Oh, take me home. Once more, Daddy can't stand anymore. The little people.
Well, you two old goats, did I solve our problem or didn't I?
Why, the child's convinced she saw the fairies. She's upstairs now, probably dreaming about them.
The way's the deed to Rena's property. She still has that, hasn't she?
Shh, quiet, she's coming. Well, Sheila, we thought you were asleep.
I was asleep. Almost. And then I took to thinking. I have everything your heart desires. But you haven't what you want at all. So if you're still set on the theater for the group, here's the deed to me property.
Oh, thank you, Sheila.
You can put the old tree out of its misery or do anything you want. It's not because I saw the little people. It's because you saw them. I know you believe because you saw them too.
Yes, Sheila. Yes, my dear.
Good night. Oh, my God, sit on your pillow.
Good night, Sheila. Good night.
Good night, my child.
Well, boys, this deed goes to Appleby tonight. I'll take it myself. The university gets its property, and the little girl has seen her fairies.
I think I'll go to bed.
Yes, I think I will, too.
Well, pleasant dreams, boys. We're sitting pretty.
Miss Sheila, ma'am, excuse me for interrupting your breakfast.
Yes, Cedric?
Well, there's a policeman, ma'am, with a message from Old Devon.
Old Devon?
They picked him up last night in a brawl, miss. The message was, he'd be obliged if you'd come and get him out of jail. Shall I call Mrs. Trumbull, miss, or the doctor?
Oh, no. Tell the policeman to wait. I'll be ready in a minute.
Now, just a minute, Old Devon. Are you trying to tell this court that you were attacked last night by supernatural beings?
George Watson, Your Honor, that I was. We met up with you at the edge of the Fairchild Estate,
And seeing as how they were the little folks trudging down the road, I invited them to join me at Murphy's Liquor Emporium.
And they went with you. The fairies went with you.
Well, sir, there we were on our way, when one of them, a North of Ireland runt named Dugan, passed a certain remark about me dear Uncle Seamus, now deceased and departed.
Will you kindly get to the point?
Naturally, I remarked right back at him and doubled it. And then this pusillanimous lump told me to shut up, or he'd knock me kneecaps off. Now, there was where I made my mistake. They all fell upon me, thousands of them. I was up to me belt buckle in fairies.
You were up to your belt buckle in whiskey.
Oh, me little... Oh, please, this thing.
Here. Just who are you, little girl?
You remember me, Judge Watson? Sheila O'Monaghan.
Oh, yes, of course. The little Irish girl.
And now that she's here, Your Honor, she'll tell you I did see the fairies last night.
Oh, yes, sir. A whole tree full of them.
Now, just a minute. Well, more visitors. Come in, Mr. Trumbull. Doctor, Mr. Findlay.
How are you, Your Honor?
I hope you'll excuse us. We just came to get the little girl, isn't it?
But, gentlemen, oh, Gavin's in trouble. His Excellency doesn't believe that we saw the fairies last night.
Sheila, we mustn't interrupt the court.
But I'm just asking you that you tell the judge what you saw with your own eyes. You did see the fairies last night. You did.
Sheila, dear, what difference does it make?
But don't you see what you're doing? You're sending old Gavin to prison for telling the truth. Then, why don't you speak?
Gentlemen, did you see fairies last night? Or did you not?
Sheila, my dear, it was just a sort of a game, my dear.
Yes, dear, just a little game.
Then you don't believe. And after you saw them leaving the tree. Oh,
never mind, darling. Never mind, my lady.
But there must be fairies. There must. I couldn't live if there weren't. I wouldn't want to.
Sheila?
Yes, Your Excellency.
Come here, child. Here to the window.
Yes?
You too, O'Davin.
Yes, Your Excellency.
Are those the fairies you saw? The little people out there in the prison yard.
The little folks, they're here. A miracle.
But they're not fairies, Sheila. They're midgets. Dugan's midgets from the vaudeville theater.
But, Davin.
The judge is right, my lady. Midgets. Just humans, darling, who never grew up. And me squaring to pixies I might talk with.
And if they're humans, the real fairies are still in my tree. We're going to cut it down and kill them all.
Sheila, my dear, we did it only to make you happy.
Make me happy? You make me wish I were dead.
Bailiff, release the midgets. The case is dismissed.
Well, thank you very much, Your Honor.
I'm not through with you. I want to see all of you right away in my chamber.
And that's what they've done to her, Your Honor. And that's why I say they're three contemptible low-down weasels.
Are you drunken? Judge, I demand O'Devon be thrown out.
Before you do any demanding, Mr. Findlay, I suggest you answer his accusations. Did you hire Dugan's midget?
Yes, but only...
And second, is it true or not that you brought this child into your home only to acquire her property?
Your Honor, please, now, but...
Well, Dr. Vaughn...
Yes, it's so. We were in a difficult situation, and, well, it seemed the simplest solution. But we've changed since he came to us. I can't explain it, except we've never heard a little girl laugh before, or waited for a good night kiss, frightened to death she might forget it. You couldn't take her away from us now, Judge. Why, we wouldn't be able to just... Well, hang it, man, we love her.
How can you love me? Dressing up little humans to pretend that they were fairies.
But Sheila, we do love you. You're the only one we've ever loved. Except your grandmother. Now, please, tell Judge Watson that you want to stay with us.
And I'll buy you a pony, Sheila. A nice red pony.
A red pony. You can't buy love for pounds and pence.
I was so happy last night. I thought that you believed in the fairies. And how they'd help you get rid of your sinful old money. And lead you into heaven. But it's too late. I can't go back with you.
You won't have to, Sheila. Mr. Findlay, Dr. Gaunt, Mr. Trumbull. Consider yourselves discharged as the child's guardian.
Ah, but Judge...
Bailiff?
But...
Yes, sir?
Get the matron. We'll arrange to commit the child to the state home for orphans.
Oh, no. I won't go.
But this is absurd, Your Honor. She has plenty of money, the money we paid for her property.
And I'll not touch a penny of it. Not a penny.
Your Honor, she's a Monaghan. She can't go to an institution.
Sorry, O'Davin, there's no alternative.
Yes, sir. Oh, look at you.
three wise men. After what you've done, it's you who should be put in an institution to rot behind bars for the rest of your selfish lives. Three wise men. Three wise fools.
That'll be enough of that.
Oh, Davin, help me, please. Oh, Davin, help me.
Oh, alternative, he says, darling. Oh, over me dead body, there ain't. Come on, me lady, run, run.
Stop, stop, stop.
You'll never stop. You'll never stop.
Run, me lady, run, run. Come on.
We pause now for station identification. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.
In just a moment, Margaret O'Brien, Lionel Barrymore, Lewis Stone, and Edward Arnold will return in Three Wise Fools. Our guest tonight is proof that miracles can and do happen in Hollywood. She's lovely Janet Leigh, who at the age of 19 has been chosen for one of the most important screen roles of the year. In Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer, The Romance of Rosie Ridge. Won't you give us a few highlights of your success story, Janet? And don't be modest.
Well, I really haven't had a chance to catch my breath yet, Mr. Keeley. Everything happened so fast. First came my contract, the studio, and then my first picture role in a romantic drama of the period following the Civil War. And, well, you know who the hero is, Mr. Keeling, so you understand why I can hardly believe my good luck to be playing opposite him.
The popular Van Johnson. And he has the most versatile role of his career in that picture, a two-fisted fighting man.
Oh, Van does some fine singing, too. American folk songs to his own guitar accompaniment. Well, it was also fun to work with such a famous member of the cast as Thomas Mitchell.
A truly splendid character actor. How did you like going on location for The Romance of Rosie Ridge in the high Sierras?
Oh, it was rugged, but it was beautiful up there. No contact with the outside world for 2 weeks, so I had to be sure to pack carefully. Oh, and I know Mr. Kennedy would be interested to hear of one suggestion I got over and over again.
I'm thinking of a certain beauty soap that's rather popular in Hollywood, Miss Lee.
Yes, Mr. Kennedy. Everyone said, be sure to take a supply of Lux Toilet Soap. As though I forget my daily complexion care. I've been using Lux Toilet Soap for a long time, you know.
Maybe that's one reason the studio didn't even make a screen test of you, Miss Lee. Any cameraman knows a lovely Lux complexion always photographed like a charm.
Thank you, Mr. Kennedy.
Hollywood stars and starlets know how effective Lux Toilet Soap care can be. The rich, fragrant lather makes Lux Toilet Soap their favorite bath soap, too. It's truly Hollywood's own beauty soap. Thanks for being here tonight, Miss Janet Leigh. All good wishes in your bright new career. Here's your producer, William Keeley.
Act 3 of Three Wise Fools, starring Margaret O'Brien as Sheila, Lionel Barrymore as Gaunt, Lewis Stone as Trumbull, and Edward Arnold as Finley. Several hours have passed, but neither the police nor the frantic efforts of the three old bachelors have revealed any trace of Sheila and O'Davin. Slipping through town, the runaways have halted at an iron front gate. On it, a bronze plaque reads, St. Mary's Convent.
But, darling, darling, you can't. You can't enter a convent.
Mind is made up, O'Davin. I'm denouncing the world. Sure, it is nothing but a great ball of news and lies.
But we could run away, my lady. Out west. Kentucky. Or Maine. We'll become Indians.
No, Davin. Thank you, but no. He places in a convent. What more can I do with my wasted life? To let him cut off his hair and have done with it.
Oh, what's to become of me? Left to die in a drunkard's grave.
Oh, my poor, poor man. But you've got to be brave. I'll be praying for you every second beat.
Oh, worry, worry, worry.
You promised me you'll have no more dealings with Mr. Kilgarren's Irish whiskey.
Not a thimbleful. Not a whiff.
Then go, Davin. Go now. And God keep step with you.
What time is it now, Richard?
It's 10 minutes to 10. And in 5 minutes, it'll be 5 minutes to 10.
And if you ask me once more, I'll ram that clock right down your throat.
Well, I can't help it. I'm worried.
Don't worry.
If it hadn't been for you and your midget flea circus, Sheila'd still be here.
Oh, sure. Blame me. Everything, anytime anything happens around here, it's my fault.
Yap.
For 40 years,
I've listened to your yapping. I'm getting tired of it.
All right, I'll leave this house tomorrow.
Good! I can't wait to get your room fumigated.
Gentlemen, she insists on seeing you.
Who insists on seeing us?
I do. See you, I will. I insist to marry Bridget from the convent. I come for Sheila's clothes.
Oh, you found her.
She found us, poor little tyke.
Oh, thank heaven, she saved.
Sister, you have influence in this town. Help us get her back, please.
I hope you'll never get her back. I've just been to see Judge Watson. There's a fine boarding school upstate. I'm taking her there myself tomorrow. So send off your man to fetch her clothes.
Get her clothes, Frederick?
Yes, sir.
The three biggest men in this town, are you? The three blackest sinners.
We tried to buy the property back, but they've already started to clear the land.
I know all about it.
What we did was wrong, and we know that.
And what do you know of the mind of a child? Denying her the fairies, calling them superstition. Would you be denying Santa Claus and the Easter Bunny and the stork? You took everything from her she believed in. And now she wants to die.
But surely there's something we can do.
The only thing I know is to save that tree.
But that's impossible.
Is it? Before I let them cut it down, I'd nail myself to the trunk and make them cut me down with it. Ah, but you won't do anything. You just haven't got the courage or the love. I'll wait in the carriage for the child, please.
Hello, Acme Contracting Company.
Hello, hello, Mr. Johnson. This is Quimby.
Yeah, you got that ground clear yet?
That's just it, Mr. Johnson. It's a big oak tree. When we came to work this morning, he was chained to it.
What are you talking about?
Dr. Gordy chained himself to the tree. We can't cut it down.
Yeah, but you got to cut it down. Wait, I'll be out there in 10 minutes. Hey, Sam, get hold of Appleby at the university right away.
Get back to work, you man. I think I can take care of Dr.
Gordon.
Oh, you can you?
Yes. Now, what's the idea of chaining yourself to this tree?
So you can't cut it down, that's why.
But we got to cut it down. We got to clear the property, don't we?
You're not cutting down this tree.
Dr. Gordon. Oh, Dr. Gordon. What on earth's the matter? Who chained you to the tree?
He did it himself, Mr. Apple.
You are not cutting down this tree.
But, Doctor, people will think you're crazy. You'll be ruined. Come on, open the padlock. Where's the key?
I gave it to a gopher.
This property belongs to the university. I'll call the police.
Well, go ahead.
You starved to death.
Well, then tell him the flatfoot to bring me a sandwich.
I'll tell him. Now, will you guys get back to work?
Then I'll have a trick in my
head. Oh, devil!
I thought it is. It's another trick.
Oh, where is she, old man? Is Sheila here yet?
Here? So you can hurt her again?
I don't want to hurt her. I'm just trying to save her tree.
Well, then you believe?
Would I be doing this if I didn't?
Look me in the eye. Do you believe in fairies? Yes or no?
No.
So I was right. It is a deception.
Yes, it's a deception, yes. But don't you see? I'm trying to give that child her faith again. Now stay here, old Davin. Help me convince her.
She's coming here.
I sent Frederick to the convent.
I shall not budge a step after what you've done to her.
Then you get her yourself. You've got to now. Now, to meet before they take her out of town.
I'll try.
And hurry, old Davin. Hurry. Well, Dr. Gordon. Mr. Badger. What do you want, you buzzard?
Always said you'd wind up in chains.
Yeah.
Where are your accomplices? Where's Findlay and Trumbull?
I don't know.
Stand by, boys. Take down everything he says.
We will, boys.
You are my reporters, man. Oh, Mr. Appleby's here, too, I see.
I brought the policeman, Doctor. Now, unless you give us the key to that padlock, we'll cut you loose with a hacksaw. Where's that key?
Go ask the gopher.
Oh, come on, Doc. What's the idea?
You wouldn't understand, you pot-bellied pencil pusher.
Just give us one reason, one little reason for all this nonsense.
I have chained myself to this tree because it's the home of the fairies.
The fairies? What fairies?
You really believe that, Gorse? I don't see any fairies.
Well, neither do I. But they're in this tree, all right.
Hold on. Wait a minute.
I'll take care of this.
Well, Mr. James Trumbull.
Oh, I hate to say this, Mr. Trumbull, but I do believe Dr. Gaunt has lost his mind.
Save your breath, Jim. You wouldn't believe in fairies if I showed you their birth certificate.
Richard. Richard, what you're doing is a wonderful thing, but it won't save the tree.
I know that.
What's the good of it, then?
Well, at least it may restore her belief in... Well, it's not in fairies, but at least in human beings.
But Sheila's gone, hasn't she?
I sent O'Davin for her. If he brings her here, she'll realize that at least one of us hasn't let her down.
Oh, I see, I see. You mean that no one here believes in fairies but you? None of these good people?
Jim, I love you.
Thanks, thanks. Well, then, Doctor... I'm standing here with you until they dynamite us out.
That's a great idea. Now, but I guess we better try the hacksaw first.
Well, Mr. Trumbull, don't tell me you believe in fairies.
Your skepticism does you a little justice, Mr. Badger. The manifestations of the supernatural have been known throughout the ages.
Hallelujah.
Get that, Charlie, word for word. Tell us more now. Like what do fairies eat?
Honey, of course. Honey and garlic.
And what do they drink?
Grasshoppers, milk, and sap. You sap.
I got her. Oh, come on now, gentlemen. Never through here.
Play along with me, James. We've got to do it. We've got to put on an act for it.
Yes, I know. Look, Richard. Up on that limb. There. Five of them. Five pink fairies.
Imagine. And they're all strumming their harps.
Harps?
Well, can't you hear them?
Yeah, of course I can. Yeah, I can hear them as well as you can. Well, Sheila, hello, my dear.
Good morning. Oh, Davin, you can see the fairies and I can't.
Ah, but you will, my lady. You will.
And look, Doctor. There's another group. And they're eating oatmeal.
Oatmeal? Nonsense. That's buttercup mush.
Do they believe, O'Davin? Do they really believe?
They do indeed, my lady.
Oh, Sheila, darling, Sheila.
You do believe. You do believe.
Can you forgive us, my dear? Can you?
Oh, I love you. I do love you.
Now don't cry, Sheila. Please don't cry now.
I won't. Where's Mr. Finley?
Well, we don't know, Sheila.
There he is. Conniving over yonder with Mr. Appleby. Why isn't he with you, protecting his tree?
I don't know, the overstuffed miser.
I'll take care of him. Excuse me, my lady. I'm about to beat up on the first millionaire.
Oh, he doesn't.
All right, boys, get those stars in action.
Okay.
Well, canes or no canes, we won't budge any.
Come on, stand aside over here. Come on.
Oh, no. Please don't cut it down. Please don't.
Hey, you better take her, Mr. Badger.
Oh, no. Don't cut it down. The fairies. He'll kill them all.
Sheila, dear.
Dad, let the tree alone. It's all fixed. The tree can stand.
What did he say?
Look what I've got.
A church.
A check for $1 million. $1 million. Mr. Finley. Sell us back this property, he said, and I'll give you $1 million.
Ted did that.
So, I accepted, naturally.
$1 million, naturally.
We'll make it into a park, he said. Then the tree can stand forever.
Not just a park, Findlay Park. That's part of the deal, Appleby.
Mr. Findlay, you gave your last $1 million to save the tree.
Well, why not?
Oh, Ted.
Sheila's forgiven us, Ted. Can you?
No, I guess I'd better. Looks like you two will have to take some care of me from now on.
Oh, was there ever such happiness? And we have the fairies to thank for it. The glorious little creatures. But I wish I could see them like you do.
Show them to her, Ted. Show them to her. See, there. Hmm? Oh, that's second glance.
Oh, yes, why, certainly. Now concentrate, Sheila. They're right up there on the... Well, of course you can't see them. The words, Sheila. The incantation.
Oh, I'm sure you have to get me there.
Shut up, everybody!
He seems to be rather small. Ace the green on the knees. Starting guard, there the glory. The last machine left the last.
Well, Sheila? Well?
I can see them. The fairies, they're there.
You bet they are, darling. Right in the middle of Finley Park.
curtain falls on a splendid performance from our four stars. And here they are at the footlights. Margaret O'Brien, Lionel Barrymore, Lewis Stone, and Edward Arnold. Sure, and it's a fine accounting you gave of yourself, Margaret, my darling.
Excuse my thinking, Mr. Keeley.
You almost had me seeing those little people myself.
What does a leprechaun look like, Margaret?
Oh, they have big ears and pointy turnip noses.
Can you vouch for that for sure?
Well, of course, they really aren't such people. Oh, maybe they are.
As you said yourself, what makes that window blind go and fly up when nobody's around?
Could be the sound effects, man.
Right, Margaret. And I can see you're right about another thing, too. Lux Toilet Soap. I'm sure that nice, smooth complexion means you use it regularly.
Oh, I do. I use Lux Soap every single day of my life.
And that's more evidence that you're a very wise and up-to-date young lady.
And you know, Bill, Margaret's added another skill to her many talents out of Metro-Goldwyn-Mayer.
So I understand. Learning the ballet for her newest picture, The Unfinished Dance.
Well, that's quite an accomplishment, Margaret. Was it difficult?
No, but in the middle of making the picture, I hurt my toe and couldn't dance.
Oh. Well, is that why they call it The Unfinished Dance?
No.
Oh, why do they?
We'd have to go to the theater and find out.
But coming back to your toe, Margaret, did it mean that you couldn't dance in the ballet?
No. Mr. Paskanath, the producer, promised me I could be in the ballet. So he postponed shooting it until my toe healed.
Ah, well, Margaret, you must never break your promise to a little girl.
Did you ever dance ballet, Mr. Barrymore?
No. No, I'm afraid I'm hardly the type.
Did you ever toe dance, Mr. Arnold?
Only on other people's toes.
Well, I don't know about his dancing, Margaret, but Mr. Arnold gives a fine performance for MGM in The Huckster.
Thank you, Bill. And speaking of pictures, what are you doing on Lux next Monday night?
We're fortunate in having a delightful and nostalgic play in 20th Century Fox's Margie, starring Gene Crane and Glenn Langan in their original screen roles. Margie is a warmly sympathetic story of teenage romance, its trials and triumphs, joys and heartaches. A play that's filled with the spirit of youth and humor and brightened by the lilting tunes of the 20s.
I love Margie, Mr. Keeley, and I'm sure your audience will, too. Good night.
Good night.
Good night. Good night. Good night. Thanks for a wonderful evening. Lever Brothers Company, the makers of Lux Toilet Soap, join me in inviting you to be with us again next Monday evening when the Lux Radio Theater presents Gene Crane and Glenn Langan in Margie. This is William Keeley saying good night to you from Hollywood.
Be sure to listen next Monday night to the Lux Radio Theater presentation of Margie with Gene Crane and Glenn Langan. Stay tuned for My Friend Irma, which follows immediately over most of these stations. This is CBS, the Columbia Broadcasting System.